Okay, thank you. So I'll be talking about Glowing Bear, which is the working name for a modern user interface for Transmart, which uses the REST API. I'll first tell something about IMI Translocation, the project under which this UI is being developed. The principles that we use for the new UI. Then something about Glowing Bear itself, the design, the current status, and the roadmap. And then there's some room for questions. So first, IMI Translocation. Case already mentioned something about this during his presentation, but it's part of the Innovative Medicines Initiative, and it's... Okay, don't touch the laptop. It's part of the IMI Antimicrobial Resistance Program.
And re-plug that cable back in since it lost the connection.
Yeah, so it's the project is trying to integrate existing knowledge from the preclinical field and the clinical field, and the storage, the data storage for the clinical data is Transmart. To facilitate this in the project, we're extending the REST API, and that's something you can see here. So on the on the right on the slide, you see here the Transmart database for the clinical data, and for the preclinical data, they're using a program called LSP, and to integrate this data, they've chosen to use the REST API and R and Spotfire to download the data from two different sources. So the majority of the project is focused on this this part, but there's also room for the graphic user interface. And this user interface is being developed with input from the whole Transmart community, so it's not only a user interface that gets its requirements from the Translocation project. So to facilitate the needs for the project, the REST API had to be extended. So the REST API was extended to support, for example, more constraints. As they wanted to use the R, part of the work is also extending the R client. So they reduced the data download overhead because to improve the performance, and they, as I said, extended the constraints. So now you have the option to, for example, say I only want to download my data for this particular biomarker or for this particular patient set. And we started working on the new UI. And the working name, as I mentioned, is Glowing Bear. So the new UI is CBio Portal inspired, so it's an interactive framework. It uses the same similar web technologies, and it's built upon the REST API, so it's completely separated from Transmart Core. And it was well received in during the Bremen meeting, which is an annual meeting for the Translocation project. And as I mentioned, the use cases for the UI are provided by the whole Transmart community. So now, next I would like to go into the principles, but before I do, I would like to go over what we are trying to learn from the old UI. And one of the most important things here is to improve the user experience compared to the old UI, because the old UI has sometimes an outdated look and feel. There's a steep learning curve, and the feedback is not always clear. So with this I mean, if you fill in a list of... so you try to make a cohort, you drag in all your concepts of interest, and then you hit summary statistics, and then you see that you have an empty cohort. We're trying to fix this. Another one is, for example, an error when you're trying to run an advanced workflow. Basically, get a more interactive, intuitive UI. A second problem that the current UI has, or the Transmart app, is that it has technological debt. There, it does not have a good testing framework. It's an old-fashioned server architecture. And there's no separations of concerns. So if you want to build new features, this becomes harder over time. because the code quality goes down, it takes longer to implement new features and therefore will be more expensive. And one thing is there's no test coverage for this UI. Which brings me to the goals of the new UI, which is to replace the old UI for all common use cases, so cohort selection, some advanced workflows, data export, improve the cohort selection to improve usability, improve user experience, and leverage the new functionality, improved REST API that's being built in the 70.1 project. And this includes longitudinal data support, modifier support, cross-study support, and data linking to third parties, in this case Arvados. So the principles that we have, the main principles that we try to live by for this UI is we want to have a responsive UI, in which we mean that the feedback needs to the user needs to be very clear. It needs to be informative UI, so when you use the UI to explore your data, it needs to show you what data is there. It needs to be intuitive, so the learning curve goes down and new users want to use the UI. So it should be a low threshold to start. So with responsive, as I mentioned, I meant feedback. So you input everything into the system and then you expect outputs, and when it breaks, it gives feedback here. And what we are trying to do with the new UI is give the feedback the moment you put something into the system and it's not working, it should give feedback to the user. An example from, for example, SmartR here is that you see, oh, I'm trying to do an analysis, but I'm missing data. So please give me a numeric variable to add in this box. So it's local. It's a good location. It's a very clear message. And it's early enough for the user to fix the problem themselves. Another one, this is an actual histogram from the new UI, where you see if you select a range of data that you're interested in, it directly gives you back the amount of subjects or patients you have selected, in this case, for the age range. The second principle was informative, so give insight into what the data has to offer. And this we are trying to do by showing ranges and distributions. So for numerical data, you get histograms, and for the categoricals, you get pie charts. The figures are linked, so if you select one range here, then the distributions in this pie chart will update. And the other way around, if you select a slice of interest, the histogram will show the appropriate ranges. And one thing is that we want to maintain the information flow through the system so that the current Transmart UI has, maybe improve it a little bit. And with intuitive, we want to flatten the learning curve, lower the threshold for new users so they actually try me. We want to have more users try Transmart and get hooked on it. Basically, change the amount of effort the users have to invest before the experience becomes good to a lower one, where the experience is more satisfying at an earlier stage. And as it's a scientific tool, we don't mind there being a learning curve, but the transition to the more complex use cases should be dynamic. So to go into the design, as I mentioned, it's in the new UI is an interactive dynamic web application, which is inspired by on CBio portal. And one important thing that we wanted to do here is have a separation of concerns. So this means that the UI actually is independent from the Transmart core, and they communicate using the REST API. This creates a modular system with a separate backend and frontend, which is easier to maintain. And in this case here, you see that I've put a box with the processing power, long-running jobs, and data storage should all be provided by Transmart Core DB and Core API. But this also can be extended, for example, the Arvados, so you can see other tools which all communicate via the REST API to one frontend. The second part is that we not only want to have the separation of concerns in the over the layers between the frontend and the backend, but also in the frontend itself. And to do this, we created the plugin architecture. So you can see here, then the glowing bear is primarily used for cohort selection and data exploration. And if you want to do, for example, advanced workflows that's being replaced by SmartR, then you can plug in SmartR, and SmartR has its own concerns to take care of. As it's mentioned here, why? To simplify development and keep maintainers easier. One thing that we're doing in this project is also code that's being produced for the UI has to be accommodated by tests. This is to avoid regression, so when new features get added, there's actually tests that capture breaking changes. It's to maintain the quality of the product. So what you can see here on the screen is a picture from code coverage over the last 6 months for the Glowingbear UI. And you can see that we've invested in increasing the actual test coverage of the new software. Interesting enough, it drops at a few points. So this here, the first drop is when we first introduced SmartR, and the first introduction was just merging the SmartR code base with actual base UI code base, and SmartR does not have tests. So you see that the test coverage drops, and these are the lines of code that SmartR added. After we've decided that we should remove this and find a different way, so that's when we came up with the plugin architecture. The second drop was a mistake by one of the developers when pushing his changes to GitHub, forgetting to include the tests. And this is the second iteration of SmartR, where we decided to temporarily put SmartR back for demo purposes. And since last week, it's been deployed in using the plugin architecture. And here you can see the 3 month period, so a little bit zoomed in, and you see that the test coverage goes up to its old level again. So now it's SmartR's responsibility to include tests for that part of the software, and the UI has a coverage of about 70% at the moment. This is a lot higher than the old UI, because the old UI has a test coverage of 0.00%. So recent additions that we have done, because we have made long or great steps in the last few months. So this is a screenshot from the UI, which I will give a live demonstration after this slide. It now supports up to two cohorts, because at the beginning you could only support or only select one cohort. We've done some work on the cohort grid. We've made it possible to save and retrieve cohorts in the UI. We've included the plugin architecture with SmartR support, and we have added searching on study level metadata, which at the moment is only a free text search. So with this, I'm go to the new UI. So when you first go to the new UI, you get prompted with a login screen. Yes. Zoom in. And you get an additional authentication, because it's using the REST API. So here you actually give it authorization to use the REST API. Then on the left, you see the tree structure, as is in the current Transmart as well. And the big screen on the right is what we call the workspace. And here you have an area to drag and drop concepts. So one thing, if you click on the nodes, they will expand, and you can see the concepts underneath the tree. Right-clicking on the node will give a pop-up with the metadata. And the searching, so now I have a list of studies, and I'm only interested in the ones that use COPD. So when there's COPD in the metadata and you hit enter, then you see that it only returns the study of interest. So now you have the option to either go further down into the tree and opening all of the nodes, and then it retrieves the data, or you can drag and drop this folder into the workspace, and you will see that it will generate the figures. Each of these figures is scalable, so you can pick it up, make it larger and smaller to basically enlarge what you're interested in, and you can left click and drag to make a selection. And as you can see, all the the graphs are linked to each other and update when you make a selection. You can clear filters using, for example, this button here, or you can use the toolbar, which clears the whole workspace at the same time, or you can clear your whole workspace by hitting the little eraser button. You can also extend, in this case, the categorical node and say, for example, I'm only interested in my control group, and then you drag in the control group, then it will give you only the selection for this particular particular categorical option. So now I've made a selection. You can see there's 19 patients selected out of 58, and I want to have a closer look. Then I can go to the cohort grid at the top, and nothing much has changed here. You have the option to indicate which cohort you want to look at, which is only interesting when you have two cohorts. I'll show that after this. You can sort the data by column, and you have the option in the top right here to click it and export the data as a CSV file. So then you have the option to create a new cohort panel, which creates an empty panel, or if you want to have a closer look into the group or create a group that you want to compare, you could say, okay, I want to duplicate this, and then you see it duplicates your selection already, and you can then further refine selection. And then if you look at the cohort grid now, you see that there's, for example here, there's one patient that's only in cohort one and one that's in both the cohorts. So one feature that was recently added was the option to save cohorts and the option to retrieve these saved cohorts. So here you see three cohorts that were saved in the backend, and you can indicate like, okay, I'm interested in this cohort, please load this cohort, and then it will show you the selection you've made for the study. Okay. So now I want to create a new cohort, select some interesting variables, and then I can use the toolbar again to save the cohort here, and then you can give it a name. And when you save the cohort, it will give you feedback in the top right corner indicating, okay, the cohort was saved correctly, and this is the ID and the size of the cohort. There's some more visualizations in the front end here, where you can combine these graphs to create more. I'll show, for example, comparing a numerical with a categorical variable creates a box plot to show you the distribution. Combining two numerical variables will create a scatter plot, which you can also use to select your data and which will update interactively. And last one is combining two categoricals, which will produce a heat map with intensities. Okay, so the cohort that we just saved prior can be used using SmartR. So SmartR is added as a plugin. So you could say, okay, I want to make make a heat map for this cohort, and then you can drag in a set of high-dimensional data, and you have the ability to add gene filters here, which is autocomplete. Although I think the internet here is not fast enough for that. Yeah. And then you can fetch the data. So now it's querying the database to fetch the data, and then it gives a distribution over the log intensity values that it retrieved. Then you can go to the next step, use aggregate probes if you want to do that. For now, we'll skip this step, and you can run the analysis. In this case, I'll just run the default. and it will create a heat map for one gene. And you can, well, this is the basic smart R functionality. Okay. With that, I would like to continue with what's currently in development and the roadmap. So currently in development, we're actively working on the data export, for which we're adjusting the REST API to support this. And this feature can still be developed fully under the translocation budget, so it's fully funded. And the planned roadmap, and this is based on feedback, part of it from the transport community that we got. So the hot features that we want to include is the longitudinal data, the improved study selection, file linking, cross-study support, and improved the smarter workflow. And some features we would like to include, but are more toward the future, are extend the searching capabilities to also search for concepts. And the metadata and concepts, the front page, which can show you the study changes statistics, and advanced visualization, so some more options to create, for example, line graphs, and some notebook support in which you can add your own analysis. So for the longitudinal data, we're waiting for the 17.1 backend implementation, as they are extending the REST API to support that in that project. It will support temporal relations in the data queries, and the UI component is in the design phase now. Improve the SmartR workflow, as I just showed you, you first have to save your cohort to be able to use it in SmartR, and we would like to extend this so it's more, you can use it more like the current UI, where you don't have to save your cohort anymore, you can just make it in the cohort selection panel and then go to SmartR and do your analysis directly. Part of this is funded, so we can do some of the work. And improved study selection means that if you have a long list of studies and you only want to search studies of interest, we would like to make Transmart support controlled vocabularies using the REST API. And you should be able to search, for example, I'm only interested in studies that have this gene in high dimensional data, and it should only give you back those studies of interest. And the front page to show you some recently loaded studies, what kind of data types, those kind of statistics on basically the welcoming page. And we probably have some funding for this. And the last section of the roadmap is the file linking, and within the 17.1 project, it's the linking to Arvados. Cross-study support, extend the searching concept and metadata to allow searching for concepts, and advanced visualizations where, line graphs with data transformation. So as, I think it's the first keynote on the first day by Professor Smar, he showed that it's important you should be able, especially with longitudinal data, you should be able to make line graphs. So I think that this would be a nice addition to have in the UI. And notebook support, where you can use, for example, Jupyter Notebook to write your own analysis or have your bioinformatician write an analysis and save and store it in the UI, where you can rerun it yourself. Which brings me to my last slide. As I mentioned, we do not have funding for all of the features that we like to include, but if you want to contribute or test the UI, please come in contact with us by either talking to us here at the conference or emailing us directly. With that, are there any questions?